Hey, y'all, Kevin Queen here. No need to worry. I'll be in for the teaching in just a moment. But I want to kick off this series, Trust Fall, with this idea, because many of us, when we think about Trust Fall, we think of being in the Sheraton ballroom, you know, with everybody from work. We've gone there for an offsite, and we got some motivational speaker who's trying to get everybody to be together in this. And so he wants to help us trust, so he pairs us up with people. Maybe you got paired up with Clyde from accounting, and you're not real excited about that, because the speaker told Clyde to fold his arms and kind of lean back. And if he'd just fall back, you would catch Clyde, but you're not real interested in catching Clyde, because Clyde smells like Funyuns and Old Spice, this strange combination. And you're thinking, I don't know if I want to touch Clyde, much yet catch Clyde. But then at the same time, you know that Clyde's got a bad hip. And so you're thinking, if I drop Clyde, this is not going to be good. So if that's your idea of Trust Fall, what I want you to do is I want you to set that aside. Because the idea for this series, Trust Fall, came from this rock wall right here. In fact, where we're at, we're right outside of our Nashville kids space. And this rock wall was the place where one of the pastors, Drew Powell, he had a conversation with a dad. He was talking with one of the dads. And as he was talking with this father, this father's son, his five-year-old son, was on this rock wall, and the kid was just like climbing up the wall, and he's kind of moving up as Drew's talking with the dad. The dad had his back turned to what was going on the wall, and Drew's watching this kid just kind of make his way up, shimmy his way up all the way to the top. And as Drew's watching what's happening, he's getting a little nervous because the kid's, you know, pretty ambitious, and he's moving up, and Drew's worried, like, man, this kid might take a fall. But then this kid does something. At the very top, the kid turns around, he peeks over his shoulder, looks at his dad, and then he says, "Trust fall." And then the kid throws himself back, and the dad's having the conversation, and just doesn't even break stride in the conversation, just reaches out and grabs his son, catches his son. As Drew shared that story, I was like, man, that's incredible. I mean, what blows my mind about it is not just like the cat-like speed and reflexes of the dad, but it was also the trust that this boy had. I mean, just think about it. His mental map of the world. He knew that his dad was close, and he knew that his dad was paying attention, and he knew that his dad could catch him. I mean, that wasn't the first time that they had done that, for sure, because trust had been built. You know, when we think about this series, Trust Fall, it takes me back to a conversation that I have with my wife. We were talking, and I remember I was thinking about this idea of faith, and I just asked her, I was like, Ree, how would you define faith? How do you define it? And she said, stop for a moment, and she said, trust. She said, faith is simply trusting God. And I loved that definition because it kind of took it out of like the academic, and it took it away from like the hyper-spiritual, and it just got really super practical. That faith is trust. And so then it left me with a question, like, how am I doing trusting God? Like, how am I doing trusting God right now? I mean, the question, like, how are you doing trusting God right now? Trusting him with that situation at work, or trusting with him with the struggle in marriage, or maybe with a parenting issue, or with your finances, with your bills. How are you doing trusting him with a decision that you have to make? I mean, are you trusting that he's present, that your father is there, that he cares for you? Are you trusting that he's paying attention? Are you trusting that he knows what he's doing? Are you trusting that God is good? I mean, even when circumstances are not good, are you trusting that he is? That's what we're going to talk about. And I think that's the challenge. It's trying to figure out, how do we trust God when circumstances aren't good? And sometimes we lie. And we don't even mean to, we just lie. Like when people ask us, man, how you doing? I'm good. How's your family? Good. Marriage? Good. Kids? Good. How's work? Good. School? Good. How you doing, man? I'm good. When sometimes things just aren't good. Like, sometimes if what was going on inside of us was outside of us, we'd be going to the hospital. Because people would look at us and go, that's not good what's going on with you right now. Somebody say, it takes honesty to be able to say, man, things aren't good. Now, don't hear what I'm not saying. I'm not saying that you need to share everything that's not good with everyone. That's called Facebook. I'm not saying that. But I am saying you need somebody in your life or a small group of people in your life that when things aren't good, you don't pretend. You say, it's not good. You pray for one another and you can be there for one another. Because things are not all going to be good this side of eternity. There are good things, but there are broken things also, right? I mean, all it takes is we got to look around us. We look around us, we see that there are broken marriages and there are broken hearts and there are broken relationships. There are broken families and there are broken situations at work and there are broken finances and sometimes it's just broke, right? We look around and we go, man, there are dreams that are broken. And we can see the brokenness. All we got to do is look in the mirror and see that there's a brokenness in ourselves. We live in a broken, fallen world. And when God saw the brokenness and the fallenness of this world, he didn't send a text. He didn't send flowers. He didn't send the edible fruit, like with the chocolate, although that's delicious. He didn't send that. He didn't send a voicemail. He sent his son. And Jesus stepped into the brokenness of this world, and Jesus shows us that God specializes in restoring broken things, in healing and restoring and working in our lives. And Jesus stepped into a world where things weren't good and things were broken. And he demonstrates the goodness of God. He says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. In other words, you want to know what the Father looks like? Look at me. But when we look at Jesus, we see that he lived with this relentless trust in God. He just walks into the brokenness of this world and he just trusts the Father. And he comes and he teaches us how to live and he shows us how to love and he demonstrates what a life looks like rightly related with the Father. And he tells us, you can get in on this. You can know the Father like I know the Father. And Jesus came to show us what trust looks like, and we see a glimpse of it. I mean, even on the cross, think about the cross. Jesus is on the cross, and the last thing he says is, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. In other words, I'm trusting that you're going to catch me. Even unto death, Jesus demonstrates trust in the Father, and with the resurrection, we see the power of God. But Jesus trusts the Father, and he came to show us what life looks like when we trust, to invite us into a life of trust. Now, in Jesus' life, he demonstrates for us this principle of maturity looks different in the spiritual realm than it looks in the natural. In the natural realm, when we mature, we decrease our dependence on our parents. I mean, you come into this world, you come in this world fully dependent. I mean, you can't do anything on your own. You are fully dependent on your mom and dad, on your parents to provide for you, to protect you, to feed you. Keep you safe, like you are fully dependent on your parents. My brother, he and his wife just had twins this week. And they just had twins. They had three kids already. Now, my wife and I, we have four kids. They had three kids, five and under, and then they had two more, which means that he, once again, he outdid me. So I said, you can win. But I mean, there's those twins. They came into this world and they are fully dependent. They can't do anything on their own. But over time, their maturity means that they will learn how to eat, and they will learn how to be potty trained, and they're going to learn how to make their own food. They're going to learn how to make a grilled cheese one day. They're going to learn how to tie their shoes, and they're going to learn how to drive a car, and they will learn how to get a job and how to manage money and move out. And maturity in the natural realm is decreased dependence on parents. But maturity in the spiritual, what Jesus shows us is that its maturity is evidenced by increased dependence on your Heavenly Father. That as you grow spiritually, you are more dependent on God for his wisdom and for his grace and for his presence and for his power. You are more dependent on God for his guidance in your life. That as you grow in maturity spiritually, there is a greater dependence on God. Think about the most spiritually mature people that you know. They're not the people who go, man, I am so strong, I've got this on my own. The most spiritually mature people you know, they live with this awareness of the presence and power of God in their life. They know that there is nothing in their life, nothing, no area in their life that they don't need God in. And this is what we talk about, living under the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is what Jesus came to demonstrate, what Jesus came to bring. He invited us into this kingdom where God is king over our lives and we live under his rule and reign, his presence, his power, his protection, where we live in this relationship with the king and we experience his resources in our life, that God cares for us, that we are not alone. We are not an orphan in this world, but we have a God who loves us and cares for us. And Jesus shows us what it means to live in this kingdom. And he invites us into the kingdom of God. And I want you to think about it. What area of your life? What area of your life? Do you have an area of your life where you go, you know what? I don't need God. I don't need God in that area of my life. I got this. I've got this in my own intellect. I've got this in my own talent, my own abilities, my own resources, my own network. I don't need God in this area of my life. God, I'll give you these areas, but I don't need you over here. And if we have areas in our lives where we're living as if we don't need God, they have a word for that. It's called practical atheism. Like thinking like, man, we believe in God, but yet we're living areas of our life where we're trusting not God, but we're trusting ourselves. See, we're going to live by trust. But the question is, are we trusting God with every area? Are we bringing every area of our life under his kingdom? Because all of us are trusting somebody or something or someone. But Jesus came to show us that God is always trustworthy, that he is faithful, that he is true. And so we can bring every area of our life under his rule and reign. And Jesus said, if you want to enter the kingdom, you have to enter like a child. He said, you have to have faith like a child. One time Jesus was teaching, and some parents were bringing their kids, kind of the first child dedication service with Jesus, and they were bringing their kids in for Jesus to bless them. And the disciples rebuked the families. He rebuked the kids. They were like, Jesus has more important things to do than that. And Jesus actually rebuked the disciples. And only a couple of times he got indignant. He got pretty upset, and he told the disciples, no, bring the children to me. And he brought this one child to him, and he brought a child close to him, and he used that child as an illustration. He said, hey, if you want to enter the kingdom, you got to have faith like a child. And I was thinking about this week. I was like, you know what? We can learn a lot about faith from kids, can't we? I mean, we can look at kids, and we can say, and Jesus wasn't saying be childish. He was saying be childlike. There's a big difference. He was saying be childlike in your faith. Because kids have a way of trusting, and kids have a purity, and kids have an innocence, and kids haven't perfected the art of cynicism. Kids have a way of believing, and kids have a way of hoping, and kids have a way of not pretending. Kids are comfortable in their own skin. Kids are bold and take risk. Jesus is saying, faith like a child. Kids can laugh. I read something recently that the average 3-year-old laughs 40 times a day. And the average 40-year-old laughs 3 times a day. Man, we need something of that childlike faith restored, right? And Jesus is like, you can learn a lot from these kids. And so we're talking in the series about how do we restore this childlike faith. And it made me think of when I went to Israel and got to go with my family, kind of a trip of a lifetime. And I was thinking, I don't want to waste this trip. Like, I want to experience everything I can on this trip, but I don't want to experience this trip as a pastor. I don't want to be like as a minister or as like a professional Christian. I want to experience this trip as a dad with my kids. Not like as like the reverend of the family, but like I want to see it through their eyes. And I know that, you know, I could get too serious and take myself too seriously with it. And so I was like, God, would you help me with that? And I just had this idea. It's a random idea, and I'm not suggesting that you go and do it. I'm just saying this is what and you're probably gonna think it's really silly. And so but I'm gonna share it with you. I went and got a picture of myself when I was 8 years old, and I put it as the wallpaper on my phone. And so I got little 8-year-old Kevin. He's got a big old melon. He does. It's big. And it was like a school picture. I don't know what's going on with that grin. I know something you don't know. With that, I guess he's hiding something. But then I was thinking, like, this is evidence that I'm an old man. I've got the Weather Channel app. That's just hanging out right there. But that picture, I put that on my phone to encourage me to like, see that trip and experience that, like, with a childlike faith. Like, how would 8-year-old version of me experience that? I would be fully present. I wouldn't be on my phone. I'd be fully immersed in what was going on. I'd look with eyes full of wonder and joy and life, and I'd ask a lot more questions and not feel like I had to have all the answers. And I would stop and I would embrace it, and I'd be fully alive. And I was like, how would 8-year-old version of you be experiencing your life right now? What would it look like for a childlike faith to be restored? Not to be childish, but to be childlike and to be fully alive. And so I kept that on my wallpaper. I kept that on my phone, and it's still there just to remind me, God, I want that childlike faith restored. When we were over there in Israel, we went to the Mount of Beatitudes, where Jesus gave the Sermon on the Mount. I've always thought it was interesting, like he gave that first message, he'd been writing that thing for 30 years. He'd been, as he was working as a carpenter, he's going over, he's thinking through these concepts, thinking about what he wants to teach, and there's this incredible teaching. It's three chapters in Matthew. You ought to check it out sometimes, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. Check that out. But in chapter 6, he gives this great teaching on prayer, and I want us to look at it today. In fact, it's in your program. If you're following along, you can read along there. You can look at it up on the screen. If you've got a Bible, you can open it. Matthew chapter 6, verse 5. We're going to look at it together. He says, "When you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. But truly I tell you, they've received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room and close the door and pray to your Father who is unseen. And then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they'll be heard because of their many words. But don't be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us today our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one." Now, when Jesus gives this teaching, he's hijacking prayer from the religious leaders, from the Pharisees and the Sadducees. He's taking it back and he's putting it in the hands of the people. And he's saying, don't pray like the hypocrites. And that word hypocrite was a word from Greek theater used to describe an actor. And he's like, you don't have to pretend in your prayers. You don't have to be an actor. You don't have to put on a show and put on a performance like the religious leaders. Those Pharisees and Sadducees who put on this thing. And he's like, you don't have to change your voice. Oh, blessed God, our Father. Lordeth over all that creationeth. Like, you don't have to add syllables to the ends of your words. You don't have to use the most religious jargon you could come up with. You don't have to pretend. You don't have to go on and on and on. Because your Father hears. And he's not looking for the most religious version of you. He's looking for the version of you that you really are. Because who you really are is who he really loves. So you don't have to pretend. You have to change your voice. You don't have to cram religious Christianese in there. Just rest and know you can talk to your Father. And then he says like the religious leaders, they pray, but they pray for the applause of people. He's like, if you're praying for the applause of other people, for what other people think, and when they applaud, you better enjoy it because you just got your reward. He's like, pray in a way that you realize that you're speaking to your Heavenly Father. And he says, a thing that will help you with that is that if you pull away in secret. Now, he's not saying don't ever pray in public. He's just saying don't pray for the praise of man. But he's saying when you do pray in private, when you pray in secret, it builds a conversation with God that's more about your audience with your Father in heaven than the audience of other people. It's where you can build a prayer life. And he says, I want you to go in the closet. I want you to go in the room. Some translations say inner room, which I didn't understand until we were over there in Israel and we went to Nazareth and they had this Nazareth village where you could go through and see what the houses would have looked like in that day. So a first century Palestinian house. And what we saw is that like there were two rooms in the house. Essentially, there's one big room in the house and the big room's used for eating and for socializing. And actually, they would put mats down in that big room at night and the whole family would sleep in that room. And so there was that one big, huge room where all the family would take, you know, all the activities going on in that room. And then over to the side, there was this other room. So there were two rooms, and the other room was a smaller room. It was the inner room. It was the closet. And it'd be separated by a door, and when you go into that smaller room, that was the closet where they stored things. It was used for storage of, like, you know, clothing and fabric and food and old high school yearbooks would be put away in that little room. And so Jesus is saying, when you pray, go into the inner room, go into the closet, go into that little room, and I want you to meet with a big God in a little room. And I want you to get alone where you're not around other people so that you can just talk with God and know that your Father sees what's done in secret. And he hears everything. Every prayer that you pray, your Father hears. And so get with a big God in a little room. Now, you don't have to, some of you are already thinking about your closet, and you're like, all right, how do I get a closet? Like, you don't, it doesn't have to be an actual closet. Like, some of you are already moving stuff to the attic, clearing things out. So you can, it doesn't have to be, it can be a guest room. It can be a back porch. It can be your car. It can be your office with the door shut. It can be a trails of Radnor Park. It can be in a deer stand. Just not a deer stand at Radnor Park. Like, there, I'll get you in trouble real fast, but you'll be praying. But like, there's a space, and don't get legalistic about this, but just think about this. Where is a place that you can get alone, just you and God? And when you're in that space where you're just sharing your heart, where you're just speaking to Him as your Father, and where you're sitting and you're listening and you're still, Scripture says, be still and know. Be still and know that I am God. And when we're still in that secret place, that's where we have this awareness of that we've got a big God. We've got a Father who cares for us. And it's in the secret that we meet with God. In that secret place that we're just not confused about who our audience is. We're reminded that we're meeting with Him. And it's not, listen, when you're alone with God, the beauty is you're never alone. That He is with you. And there, the Scripture, Jesus says, He says, He will reward you. Your Father sees what's done in secret, and He will reward you. And one of the ways He rewards us in prayer is with something I would call felt trust. That actually, as we're praying, we feel trust. Just like you can feel love. When somebody loves you, you feel love. I mean, just like you can feel sadness, and you can feel fear, and you can feel anxiety. There's something that happens in the place of prayer where we feel trust in God. You know, where you can just let your shoulders just, God, I can trust you. And what you say is true. And I can just share my heart with you, God. I can trust you. There's felt trust. That's one of the gifts of God, one of the things that He gives us and that He rewards us in that. And in that secret place, as we seek Him, in private prayer, and it's in private prayer that trust grows. And Jesus said, the Father sees what's done in secret, and He will reward you. I was reminded that the Father sees what's done in secret and that He rewards with something that happened a few weeks ago. My son Durham, when we were coming back from Israel, he said, I'm going to start working out for football. He's 12. He's like, I'm going to start working out for football. And I said, good, when are you going to do it? He said, every morning. I said, okay. So when we got back, he got back at 5:30 in the morning. He woke up, came down, knocked on my door. He said, Dad, what's my workout? So now I'm in CrossFit programming. That's what I'm doing for my 12-year-old. So I'm coming up with a workout, and next morning, 5:30, woke up. Some of you didn't even know 5:30 existed like two times a day. Like this, so my Duro, and he's waking up, and it's like every morning, just getting up and working out, and he's doing it every single morning. He didn't post it on Instagram. He didn't like tell other people. He's just doing it. I'm like, man, you got the discipline from your mama, because she works out every day. I worked out one time, but she's like, and I'm seeing this, and I'm like, this is crazy. And he's like, Dad, can we get a home gym? And I'm like, buddy, mom and I, your mom's got a lot more projects than a home gym. And I was like, well, maybe one day. And so he's doing this like for like weeks, every single day. And I finally just print off a list of workouts. And I'm like, okay, here's your workout for the day. And then one day my neighbor stops me. And some neighbors just moved in next door. And they said, hey, we've been moving some stuff around as we're moving in. And we like recently bought a gym, like a home gym. But we don't have anywhere to put it in this house. Do you have anywhere that you could use this? And I'm like, yeah. Absolutely. And so my wife and I, we moved it over into our garage. And when Durham got home from school, he walked in the garage and he's like, what? Like the angels. Oh, I mean, it was like, it's incredible. Like God answered his prayer that he didn't even know he had. But his heavenly Father gave him what his earthly father could not. And our heavenly Father gives us what our earthly fathers could not. When it comes to love and grace, and peace, and he provides for our needs. And sometimes he even graces us with stuff we want. But it's just out of his goodness. But he gives us the grace that we need. He gives us the love that we need. Our heavenly Father gives us what our earthly fathers could not. And it's in that private prayer, in that secret place that we have felt trust. And God loves, he loves to reward. He rewards those who earnestly seek him. But he is the reward and the rewarder. And we don't seek him just for what we can get from him. We seek him because of who he is. And that's what secret prayer, that's what the private place teaches us. That's what that secret prayer shows us. That's when we're in a little room with a big God. That's what it reveals us. God's not just demonstrating, we're not just demonstrating to God, we trust you, but God's building a heart that he can trust. Where you say, I can trust you. Jesus goes on to teach us, and he says, I'm going to teach you about prayer, and I'm going to give you a prayer. He gives us what we call the Lord's Prayer. And this is like the most famous prayer. Many of you probably, maybe you know it and you've heard it, but it's a model prayer and it's example prayer. He's not saying this is what you should pray. He said this is how you should pray. When you pray something like this. And the disciples asked Jesus, the only thing they asked Jesus to teach them how to do. Jesus gives us the Lord's Prayer two times. And the other time is when the disciples said, hey, Jesus, would you teach us how to pray? They didn't say, hey, would you teach us how to preach? Or would you teach us how to do miracles? Or would you teach us how to turn water to wine? Jesus, but would you teach us how to pray? Because I think they saw the level of trust that he walked through this world with. And they're like, we want that level of trust. Would you teach us how to have that kind of relationship with the Father? Would you teach us how to live with that kind of faith? And Jesus said, I'll do that. And then he teaches them this prayer. And over the next 4 weeks, we're going to be walking through this prayer. But today, I want us to just read it together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And so we'll be talking about this whole prayer for the next 4 weeks, but today I just want us to dial in on these two words. The two words, our Father. Jesus is the first person to ever address God as Father personally. You can go back through the Old Testament and you can look in rabbinical literature, you look at ancient Jewish texts, and you see sometimes people would say the Father, but for Jesus, he wasn't the Father, he was his Father. And Jesus said, if you're my disciples, if you're followers of me, it's not just that he's the Father, he's your Father, so we should pray together, our Father. And so what Jesus is telling you is that you have a Father in heaven, that you're not an orphan, that you're not alone, that you have a Father who loves you, who cares for you, and who gave his Son for you so that you might be restored with the Father, that you would have a relationship with your perfect heavenly Father. And in a broken world where there are broken fathers, Jesus points us to the one true Father who's the perfection of everything we've longed for in a dad. And Jesus said, when you pray, pray, our Father. What Jesus is saying, it's your birthright, it's your inheritance that you can call him daddy to. He is your Father. Man, I got four kids that call me dad. Sometimes it's dad, sometimes it's daddy, depending on what they want. I've been called Papa maybe once. My middle school daughters, they call me Father Kevin every now and then. It's not my favorite. I'll go with daddy, even if you want something. But it's just something like I know their voice when they say dad. Took Bolton, my 10-year-old, to the game, Braves game, for his birthday. We drove down to Atlanta for his birthday and went and saw the game. And, like, he loves the Braves. He loves baseball. Loves Dansby Swanson. And so we're down there. I mean, he is loving it. And it was incredible. We had an incredible time together. I mean, we're at the game. We're just making memories together. And it was, I'll tell you, there were those moments where it was just like, I paid way too much for tickets because I'm like, if we're driving all the way to Atlanta, like, we want to be close, you know. So we were down behind the dugout, and he's being able to see all his favorite players. And there was this moment where, like, hey, you know, seventh inning stretch, like, hey, we'll go up and get something to eat, maybe restroom. So we're walking up, too much information, but we're walking up the stairs. And I had this moment where I was turning around to see what was going on in the field. And when I turned back around, I couldn't find him. And there are thousands of people and people going everywhere. And I'm looking around. I can't find my boy. I can't find Bolton. And so I didn't know what to do. And so I climbed up some stairs at SunTrust Park. And I'm standing up on top of some stairs where I can see everybody. And I'm looking around. I'm seeing a lot of kids. And I'm seeing a lot of Dansby Swanson jerseys. But not my kid in a Dansby Swanson jersey. And I thought, man, I can just yell Bolton. If I just yell Bolton, maybe he'll hear my voice. And so I'm trying to find Bolton. Man, my heart starts beating super fast. And it just goes down into my stomach. And I'm beginning beginning to panic a little bit. And I'm thinking, my first thought was, my wife's going to kill me. That was my first thought. And then after that, just realized, like, this is the worst thing that I can imagine, to be in a stadium where I'm thinking, and some of you were like, well, you should have given him a ticket so that he knew where his seat was so that you guys could meet back. I'm glad you do that. I didn't. And so I'm like, next time. And so I'm like, in that moment, it was one of those times, I don't know if you ever experienced this, but seconds feel like minutes and minutes feel like hours. And I'm just, and it was probably 5 minutes, but it felt like forever. And then I heard, Dad. Because I knew that voice. I went and I wrapped him up and I was like, buddy, I was so afraid. And I was thinking, when Jesus said Father, he had Father's attention. When you say Father, you have the Father's attention. God loves you the same as he loves Jesus. He doesn't have another kind of love. What Jesus is saying is, now you're in on this relationship with the Father. If you're in Christ, he is your Father. So when you call out to him, he hears you. He knows your voice. His eyes are watching over you. God sees you. He knows your address. He knows where you're at. And the Father's heart breaks for those who are far from him. The Father's heart is not okay for those who have lost their way. The Father sees you. And he loves you. He loves you with an unconditional love. He doesn't put up with you. That's not what, God doesn't look at you and go, okay, because you're friends with my boy Jesus, I'm going to have to tolerate you because of some legal obligation. That's not the Father. The Father loves you unconditionally. He loves you so much that he gave his son for you. You're worth Jesus to God. That's how he loves you. And it's important that we get this concept of Father right. If we want to pray right, we have to see God as Father right. And for many of us, God is re-imaging our view of Father. Because I want to be a good dad. But sometimes I lose my kids in stadiums. And sometimes I lose my cool in the car. And sometimes I lose perspective on what really matters in life. And maybe you want to be a good dad, but you know you fall short too. I want to be a good dad, but I fall short. And maybe you had a dad who did the best with what he had, but he still felt short, and you got wounds from that. Or maybe you have a dad that you never knew, was absent. Or maybe an abusive situation. I'm sorry. I want to tell you something that I heard Louis Giglio say one time. He said, God is not a reflection of your earthly father. He's the perfection of everything you long for in a dad. He's not a bigger version of your dad here on earth, of your broken dad here on earth. He is the perfection of everything you've longed for in a father. And you were the apple of his eye. And he delights in you. And he loves it when you show up in the room. And he looks for you. And he says, I love you. And I'm proud of you. And I'll never give up on you. And I've got a dream and a destiny for who you be. And he invites you to a seat at the table. There's always a seat at the table for you. And he says, you are my beloved daughter. And you are my beloved son. And our father is a healer. And he will heal the wounds from your earthly father. And he invites you to know him like that. So as we talk about trusting, we have to know the kind of father that we're trusting, that he is a perfect father. And even when our circumstances are not good, he always is, and he can be trusted. So when you're on the wall, you're clinging on, you need to know he has you. He hasn't dropped one yet, that you can trust him. There's a song. It's become an anthem for the church over the past couple of years called Good, Good Father. Have you heard that song, sang that song? It's a powerful song, and it's one that many people have sung. Few people have heard the story of where it came from. There's a pastor in Atlanta. His name was Pastor Tony. Pastor like a small church, kind of a home church and a group that was together. And one night in their small group, a lady shared that she had recently gotten a diagnosis and that she had cancer. And she asked if the group would come around her and pray for her. And so they came around her and put a hand on her shoulder, and they began to pray for her. And Pastor Tony began to sing kind of a spontaneous song over her. He began to sing, "You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am." Just began to sing it. And then everybody else started joining in. They said something shifted in the room as they just embraced the reality of who God is and who they are. So you could feel trust in the room. God's presence and power pulled that circumstance under his kingdom. And experienced his peace. Experienced his presence. That's where the chorus of that song came from. But Pastor Tony, who was a co-writer on the song, something that's remarkable about his story is that he never knew his earthly father. So the place that song was written from was a deep place, because his Father in heaven was the only father he ever knew. And he is a good, good father. And he is the perfection of everything we've longed for in a dad. And so I'm going to invite you to a moment as Mike joins with me. I want to invite you to sing this song. And maybe for you, you're like Pastor Tony, and you're saying, "God, would you restore, would you heal my perspective of who you are as dad? Would you reframe who you are as father so that I can pray rightly, so that I can address you rightly, so I know I can trust you deeply?" And maybe for you today, maybe for you, it's to be just this song sung over you. And if that's you, maybe you've recently got a diagnosis, or maybe you've got a struggle that's just overwhelming for you, and you need to overwhelm that struggle with the truth that you have a good, good father. You just stay seated, and we'd love to sing over you. But I want to invite you to stand here and at all the campuses. Invite you to stand. And if you want to remain seated, you can do that and just rest in his love. We're going to sing this together and make it our song and say, "God, we are trusting in you. You're a good, good father." Would you sing with me? "You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Yes, you are. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Yes, you're good. You're a good, good father. It's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You're a good, good father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. So Father, thank you for your love for us. Thank you that you're healing our hearts. Thank you that you're making all things new. Thank you to restore what is broken. So Father, we receive your grace today. We ask that you would give us the grace to trust you. To trust you deeply. And whatever we're walking through right now, to trust that you have us. God, I pray that over these weeks that you would teach us more about who you are. Teach us where we don't see you rightly. Teach us, God, how to receive your love. And like the disciples, we ask, would you teach us how to pray? Would you teach us how to live with a deep-seated trust? Would you restore a childlike faith? God, wherever cynicism has taken root in our hearts, wherever anxiety is choking out life, Lord, would you restore, would you breathe fresh life into us? And God, would you help us live with wide-eyed wonder? And we have a Father. And we can trust. Jesus, thank you for the work you've done in us. And we pray that you do it through us so that people around us who don't know they have a Father like this would know you as their Father through us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we live. In Jesus' name we go. Amen. Amen. Have a great week in the Lord.